Hello students, before beginning this lesson, I'd like to ask you a question. What do you think is the best form of medication in this world? A medicine which has both curative as well as preventive properties? Well, I can almost hear some of you thinking of the most recent scientific advancements, the most recent antibiotics, anesthetics, drugs and the like. Well, if you are thinking on those lines, then you would be disappointed. Because the answer is quite simple. This medicine has existed from time immemorial, and this medicine is nothing but happiness. There can be no more potent medicine than being satisfied and positive, or in short, happy. If you are not confident about what I am saying, then you will be as we proceed through this lesson. Because in this lesson, we will be trying to understand the diverse and adverse impact of the opposite of happiness or distress on our physiological and psychological well-being. In addition, we'll also see what behavioral changes stress brings about in our life. Further, we'll also be dealing with another interesting topic, that is the psychophysiology of the stress response. First, we'll deal with what is the connection between stress and disease. Disease, as you know, is caused by a wide variety of factors, infections, bacteria, virus, unhealthy environmental factors and conditions. Research has revealed that stress is essentially one of those factors that contribute to disease. It is another fact that all people who experience stress do not necessarily acquire diseases. Now, the influence of stress on disease occurs through the physiological changes that accompany the stress response. One major part of this physiological change is immunosuppression. We all know how important and vital the normal functioning of the immune system is for disease prevention. Noted endocrinologist and stress researcher Hans Selye's concept of stress included the concept of immune suppression. But in those times, there was not enough evidence to actually substantiate his view. However, recent research in a relatively new field of psychoneuroimmunology has revealed that there are a number of connections between psychological factors such as stress and the functioning of physiological systems such as the neural system, the endocrine system, and the immune system. The word psychoneuroimmunology was first coined by George Solomon and Rudolf Moos in a landmark publication titled Emotions, Immunity and Disease, a Speculative Theoretical Integration in 1964. Later, pathbreaking research in this field by Robert Adder and Nicholas Cohen in 1975 demonstrated an essential relationship between the nervous system and the immune system. And as we know, the stress response actually begins with an activation of the nervous system. Now, the influence of stress on disease may actually happen through two pathways. The first is a direct pathway and the second is an indirect pathway. A major element of the direct influence of stress on disease is immunosuppression. The immunosuppression occurs through the activity of the nervous system on the immune system. This can happen through two routes, as you can see in the figure. First is the peripheral nervous system and the second is the secretion of hormones. Let us understand this first system. Now, the peripheral nervous system has important linkages as to immune system organs such as the thymus, the spleen and the lymph nodes. The activation of the sympathetic system within the peripheral nervous system during a stress response stimulates the adrenal medulla, or the inner core of the adrenal gland, to secrete catecholamines, epinephrine and norepinephrine. Now, the lymphocytes, or the white blood cells, which are vital cells in the immune system, these cells have receptors for catecholamines. Now, an increase in the secretion of epinephrine and norepinephrine during a stress response actually acts on lymphocytes in such a manner that their activity is suppressed. Or in other words, the result is immunosuppression. Now, the second means by which immunosuppression occurs during the stress response is through the secretion of hormones by the brain. These hormones travel through the bloodstream to affect target endocrine glands such as the adrenal glands, causing the adrenal cortex to release glucocorticoids such as cortisol. Now, the T cells and B cells in the immune system, which have the primary function of attacking an invading microorganism, also have receptors for glucocorticoid hormones. An increase in the secretion of glucocorticoids thus results in a suppression of the activity of these cells. Further, glucocorticoids such as cortisol also exert an anti-inflammatory effect. Now, why is this so? Because during a stress response, there is a greater chance that an organism may actually suffer from some sort of injury. In such a situation, an anti-inflammatory effect helps the organism because swelling reduces and the individual can continue with his response to the stressor. But this anti-inflammatory effect is achieved essentially through immunosuppression, a suppression of the activities of the macrophages, a type of lymphocyte which are responsible for attacking invading organisms, and also through a suppression of phagocytosis, which is the process of engulfing an invading organism and killing it. Now, apart from this influence, the brain can also lead to immunosuppression through the secretion of neurochemicals. One major neurochemical secreted by the brain is the major opioid peptide beta endorphin. Now, one of the major functions of beta endorphin is immunosuppression, and it is released in high quantities during a stress response. Lymphocytes have receptors for beta endorphin, as you can, and excess secretion of this peptide results in a suppression of lymphocyte activity. Now, apart from this factor of immunosuppression, stress can also lead to disease through the other physiological changes that are a part of the stress response. Say, for example, when you experience stress, the rate and intensity of cardiac contraction increases, and as a result, your blood pressure increases. Similarly, there is an increase of sodium retention in the kidneys because during a stress response, the bowel and the bladder sphincter close. Now, all of this can actually be a major risk factor for cardiovascular diseases, among others. Now that we have seen what is the direct pathway for the influence of stress on disease, we shall understand what is the indirect pathway. Now, an indirect effect of stress on disease may occur through either an unfavorable change or neglect in health practices. For example, you are used to exercise, you walk daily, and you take a healthy diet. But when you are stressed, you may actually neglect these practices. You may eat unhealthy food, you may no longer exercise or go for daily walks. Apart from this neglect, there can also be intentional risky behaviors. For example, excessive smoking, excessive alcoholism, or an intake of drugs, either prescription drugs or recreational drugs. Now, why does this happen? This happens either because the individual is so preoccupied with the stressor that he can no longer understand as to what is healthy and what is unhealthy for him. What is more important for him is to actually get rid of the stressor. The second factor may be that such behaviors actually help him in coping. You may see many of your friends like to eat too much when they are stressed. Especially they may binge on high calorie food such as lots of ice creams or chocolates. Even you may do so. Why? Because these things make you feel good and this helps you cope with the stressor. So when a stressor is before you, what is more important is that you want to cope with it rather than thinking about what may be healthy or unhealthy for you in the long term. A third reason may be that you are so depressed, dejected and miserable in the face of the stressor that life holds no meaning for you, and so also what is unhealthy or healthy for you is of little importance in your life. Now that we have understood how stress causes diseases, let us also have a look at as to what diseases does stress cause. And this will also help you to be aware how important it is to be happy in your lives and to maintain a high degree of positivity. In fact, stress is a moderate risk factor for a large number of psychophysiological diseases. It is a moderate to high risk factor for all sorts of headaches, either it is tension headaches or mixed headaches or the more severe kind of migraine headaches. Similarly, stress has a high correlation with infectious diseases such as common cold. Now, evidence regarding the relation of stress to cardiovascular disorders is complex. Of course, as you know, stress leads to an increase in the rate and strength of cardiac contractions, and as a result, blood pressure increases and you can suffer from hypertension. Apart from this, chronic exposure to stressors such as noise, as also sodium retention in the kidneys during stress responses, as we already discussed before, and a higher intake of sodium by individuals, especially men, during stress situations, can also be contributing factors to cardiovascular diseases. In addition, an unfavorable altering of health practices, for example, an increase in smoking, alcohol, and drug abuse, especially among men, and an increase in unhealthy food intake, especially high calorie food, and this is seen more among women, can also be factors contributing to cardiovascular disorders. Additionally, stress situations can lead to the development of type A personality patterns such as a high degree of aggressiveness, irritability, rigidity, and impatience. And this is a potent determinant of cardiovascular diseases. Apart from this, stress can cause a host of diseases, say diabetes, diarrhea, peptic ulcers, skin ailments, rheumatoid arthritis, and even premature deliveries. It can either lead to the development of these diseases or an aggravation of already existing diseases. Let us discuss some of those. For example, the high secretion of gastric acid and glucocorticoids during a stress response leads to an aggravation of peptic ulcers. Similarly, stress contributes directly to the development of type 1 diabetes or insulin-dependent diabetes due to its effect on the immune system. It also contributes to type 2 or non-insulin-dependent diabetes due to the changes in the sympathetic nervous system and obesity. Further, it may also hinder the management of diabetes by raising the blood sugar levels, and also people who are stressed may be less motivated to undergo practices which are necessary for maintaining an optimum level of blood sugar, say for example regulating the amount of sugar in their diet or going in for regular exercise. Similarly, glucocorticoids have also been identified as a major precipitator of skin ailments such as eczema and psoriasis. High levels of glucocorticoids such as cortisol can also lead to uterine contractions and some premature births, apart from posing risks to the brain development of the unborn child. Also, emotional and stressful events and feelings of anger, anxiety, stress, and trauma can actually precipitate an asthma attack among persons who already suffer from asthma. It also hinders the pain management in rheumatoid arthritis and actually leads to an aggravation of these symptoms. Now, if you thought that this was all stress could do, then you are wrong, because stress also leads to a wide range of psychological disorders as well. Stress naturally, as you know, puts people in a bad mood, and people who are in a bad mood tend to have a negative interpretation of events. They may appraise more events in the form of stressors and actually attach a great deal of stress to even normal events and may even adopt unhealthy coping practices. Stress has long been associated with a number of psychological disorders, for example, anxiety disorders such as panic disorders, phobia, and obsessive compulsive disorders, as also mood disorders such as bipolar disorder and major depressive disorder. Other disorders such as borderline personality disorder, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, chronic fatigue syndrome, and alcoholism. In fact, the main mechanism which has been found to be responsible is the HPA axis or the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, which gets activated especially during a stress response. And even antidepressants which are prescribed actually modulate the activity of this very axis. Still, conclusive evidence regarding the same is lacking. However, one thing we can be sure about is that stress is a direct contributor to one form of anxiety disorder, a severe disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, which actually directly emerges from the exposure to a traumatic event. It may be a natural disaster or a personal disaster such as the loss of a loved one, illnesses, injuries such as burns, and so on. Now, Stress can also have possible indirect effects on psychological diseases. For example, people who are experiencing a large amount of stressors may be less motivated to undergo coping practices which are necessary, especially for people who are already suffering from psychological disorders because of many reasons. So, they may actually not take regular medications or they may skip psychotherapy and counseling sessions, leading to an aggravation of the existing disorders. Now that we have understood how stress influences diseases, let us go to the second part of this chapter, that is the behavioral components of the experience of stress. Now, stress, whether it is in the form of positive stress or eustress, or whether it is in the form of negative stress or distress, does lead to certain behavioral changes. For example, positive stress may make you more focused and help you concentrate on your activities. On the other hand, distress essentially has a greater number of negative behavioral components. Now, these behavioral changes may either be short term or they may persist for a long time, depending upon the nature of the stressor. Let us discuss a few of the commonly observed behavioral changes during the experience of stress. Firstly, there has been seen an increasing occurrence of risky behaviors such as an increased consumption of alcohol, increased smoking, and increased consumption of drugs, either prescription drugs or recreational drugs, and increased consumption of unhealthy food, and so on. This actually can be extremely detrimental to your health and even can bring about psychological addictions, which tend to persist even after the stressor has been removed. A second behavioral change occurs in the form of the development of type A personality patterns. This, in fact, is a cluster of observable behaviors rather than an actual personality trait, and people tend to exhibit these behaviors when they experience some sort of stress. Examples of type A behaviors include aggressiveness, irritability, rigidity, impatience, and so on. A third behavioral change during stress may be an increase in physical and verbal aggression. This actually comes from the stressor, but is directed many a time towards innocent victims. And once a person has actually exhibited his aggression on innocent victims, he may feel guilty later on. A fourth behavioral change can be in the form of social phobia. You must have observed that people, when they are experiencing some sort of stress, they want to be alone. Even you may have experienced it yourself. They don't want to meet other people. This may either be because they want some time alone or because they are afraid that the stressor may recur in situations where there are social gatherings or an accumulation of people. For instance, you have failed in your exams and you don't want to go to parties and other gatherings because there will be people asking you how many marks did you get or did you clear the exams and so on. Although this may be a good coping effort in the short term, but it can also result in feelings of isolation and feelings of being left alone. Another very commonly observed behavioral change in stressful situations is the chewing of fingernails, also called onychophagia. We may even do it while watching a cricket match. Another behavioral change is the inability to speak. Or even if we speak, we may actually be speaking very abruptly or in a very fast mode. This is because we already have feelings of nervousness, anxiety, and restlessness. And also there is a tightening of the chest muscles and our mouth also becomes dry during stress situations. Apart from the risky behaviors I already mentioned, we may also engage in other more serious kind of risky behaviors. For instance, driving very fast, or we may even engage in self-harm in very severe cases. This may include cutting, bruising, or even burning. This may be a person's way of telling that, see, I have a high amount of stress and I need help. Another behavioral change observed is an increase or decrease in the sex drive. There can also be an inability to control your sexual impulses, and people may engage in risky sexual behaviors even when there are significant risks in the form of the contraction of HIV/AIDS. Stress can also lead to sexual dysfunctions. This may be an inability either to have or maintain an erection in men, or a loss of the sex drive in women. Another major impact of stress occurs in the form of obsessive compulsive disorder. It usually happens in chronic stressful situations where people have obsessive and repeated unpleasant thought patterns. This may actually be a result of stress or may serve as a cause of stress in itself. This is many a time accompanied by ritualized behavior patterns which are meant to neutralize the extent of stress these thought patterns bring. While it is true that many of these behavioral changes that we have discussed help the individual to cope in the short term, but the fact remains that it can be hazardous both in the short term and especially in the long term, because these behaviors can actually lead to a change in your normal behavior patterns, and these changes persist even when the stressor is no longer there. Now we go to a very interesting phenomenon, the psychophysiology of stress, how psychological and physiological mechanisms combine as the body prepares to defend itself against the stressor. Now, when an individual perceives a stressor, this message gets passed on from the sensory nerves to the brain. Now, in the brain, the message passes from the cerebral cortex via the reticular activating system and the limbic system, which is a center for emotional experiences in the brain, to the thalamus. Once the message reaches the thalamus activates the hypothalamus, and the hypothalamus stimulates two systems. The first is the endocrine system, which leads to the adrenocortical stress response, and the second is the sympathetic system, which leads to the adrenomedullary stress response. This actually triggers the response of the body to stress. First, let us see what is the adrenocortical stress response. This is also referred to commonly as the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis or the HPA axis, because the stimulation occurs in this pattern from the hypothalamus to the pituitary glands and then to the adrenal glands. The hypothalamus stimulates the pituitary gland by the release of two hormones. The first is corticotrophin releasing factor CRF, and the second is the thyrotrophic hormone releasing factor TRF. Under the influence of the corticotrophin releasing hormone or CRF, the anterior portion of the pituitary gland at the base of the brain secretes adrenocorticotrophic hormone or ACTH into the bloodstream. This ACTH travels to the endocrine glands, that is the adrenal gland, and causes the adrenal cortex or the outer portion of the adrenal gland to secrete two types of hormones. The first type is glucocorticoids and the second type is mineralocorticoids. Now, the primary glucocorticoid hormone is cortisol. The main function of cortisol is to increase the level of blood glucose and mobilize the body's energy resources. Another major function of cortisol is an anti-inflammatory effect. As we already discussed before, it prevents swelling in the case an organism experiences an injury during the stress response, so that in the absence of swelling, he can actually continue with his response. Now, the primary mineralocorticoid is aldosterone. The major function of aldosterone is an increase in blood volume, and an increase in blood volume actually makes more blood available for circulation, so that more blood can be given to the major muscle groups and other organs involved in the stress response. It is also partly responsible for raising the levels of blood pressure. Now, the other hormone released by the hypothalamus, as we already discussed and you can see in the figure, is the thyrotrophic hormone releasing factor or TRF by the anterior pituitary gland. Under the influence of thyrotrophic hormone releasing factor secreted by the hypothalamus, as the anterior pituitary gland secretes thyrotrophic hormone or TTH into the bloodstream. Now, the main function of TTH is to stimulate the thyroid gland. It leads to a number of physiological changes, such as an increase in the basal metabolic rate, a decrease in gastrointestinal activity, an increase in the depth of respiration, an increase in heart rate and blood pressure, and an increase in anxiety, which serves to reduce feelings of fatigue. Now, another function of the hypothalamus is that it stimulates the posterior pituitary gland. Till now, we were discussing about the anterior pituitary gland. Posterior pituitary gland leads to the secretion of two hormones, vasopressin or ADH and oxytocin into the bloodstream. Oxytocin and vasopressin are responsible for the contraction of smooth muscles such as the blood vessels and the intestinal musculature. This is very vital for the stress response to take place. Further, Both of these hormones also increase the permeability of the blood vessels to water and thereby serving to increase the blood pressure in stress situations. Now that we have discussed one major pathway of the stress response, that is the adrenocortical stress response by means of the HPA axis, now we'll go to the second pathway of the stress response. This is the adrenomedullary stress response, and it takes place by means of the SAM axis, or the sympathetic adrenomedullary axis. Now, the autonomic branch of the peripheral nervous system consists of two divisions. One is the sympathetic nervous system and the second is the parasympathetic nervous system. The hypothalamus, when it perceives a stressor, directly activates the sympathetic nervous system. The activation of the sympathetic nervous system leads to an activation of the adrenal medulla, or the inner portion of the adrenal gland. The result is the secretion of catecholamines such as epinephrine and norepinephrine, or adrenaline and noradrenaline. As the effect of the secretion of these hormones into the bloodstream results in a number of physiological changes. Some of these include an increase in the rate of cardiac contractions, an increase in blood pressure, an increase in the constriction of blood vessels in the skin and extremities, a dilation of the coronary arteries, a diversion of blood from the internal organs to the skeletal muscles, among others. Some other physiological changes include a dilation of pupils so that you can take as much light in as possible and clearly see the stressor. Veins in the skin constrict so that blood can be sent to the major muscle groups which are going to be involved in the stress response. The level of blood glucose increases so that more energy is available to the body cells. The muscles tense up due to the increased secretion of adrenaline and glucose. The smooth muscles, which are necessary for allowing in more oxygen into the lungs, they relax. There is a decline in the activity of the gastrointestinal and immune systems so that the energy is diverted to other muscle groups. Further, you may have a trouble in focusing on small details because the brain wants to see the bigger picture, to see where the stressor is coming from and how it can react to it. The sweat glands are stimulated so as to allow the body to regulate its temperature. The blood's clotting ability is increased and feelings of anxiety are aroused. All of this facilitates the stress response. Once the stressor has passed, the parasympathetic activation takes center stage. It contributes to bringing all these bodily indexes back to normal. Breathing, heart rate, and the activity of gastrointestinal immune systems comes back to normal, and the state of homeostasis is restored.